Philippians chapter 2 this evening, Philippians chapter 2. One of the things about summer is I get to read a lot, and probably read about 5 books. One of them that I read really got me thinking and thinking in the scriptures. Of course, reading other books never should replace the scriptures. It should just complement them. But it was a book on discernment. And some subtle traps that we sometimes fall into when we try to exercise discernment. So this evening I want to preach a message on do God's will. Do God's will. And I want to preach it out of Philippians chapter 2. We're going to look at verses 3 through 13 with an emphasis on 13. The Bible says, "Let nothing be done through strife or vainglory, but in lowliness of mind. Let each esteem other better than themselves. Look not every man on his own things, but every man also on the things of others. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who, being in the form of God, thought it not robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation, and took upon him the form of a servant, and was made in the likeness of men. And being found in fashion as a man, he humbled himself, and became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. Wherefore God also hath highly exalted him, and given him a name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow, of things in heaven and things in earth and things under the earth, and that every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Wherefore, my beloved, as ye have always obeyed, not as in my presence only, but now much more in my absence, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. For it is God which worketh in you both to will and to do of his good pleasure. Verse 13 again is our focus tonight. For it is God which worketh in you both to will and to do of his good pleasure. Let's pray. Father, we thank you so much for the opportunity this evening to look into the Word of God. And it truly, it's there that we find your will. Lord, this evening, I pray that you'd work in the hearts of Christians. I pray that you'd help them to have a desire to seek you and to seek your face. Father, I pray that this evening there be people who need to make decisions, who need to step out and begin doing those things that you've placed in their hearts, in their minds, and their lives, but they're hesitating. Father, give them courage by your Holy Spirit to do that which you are calling them to do. And for those that are doing your will, we pray that you strengthen and encourage their hearts. Give us wisdom as we look at the Scriptures, and in them may we see the face of Jesus. And we pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Philippians chapter 2 and verse 13, it ought to be an encouragement to us that God is doing a work in each and every one of us, and that God is the one who works out his will in our life. That we don't have to trust in ourselves or our own strength, that we don't have to be caught up in our inabilities, but rather we can let God work through us. There's a subtle trap Christians sometimes fall into, and that is they seek to know God's will for their life, and in the seeking of that, neglect to seek God. If you look at the beginning of the verse, it says, "For it is God." Everything in the life of Christian ought to start with God. And a second subtle trap that Christians sometimes fall into is they want God to reveal his will to them so then they can choose whether or not to do it. That's not how God works. God is one who gives commands, and he expects those commands to be obeyed. That is, if we're going to seek God and if we're going to seek his will, it ought to be with an attitude of this: God, I don't know what you want me to do, but if you'll show it to me, then I will do it. And I need your strength and your help to do that thing. Obviously, there's words of encouragement and instruction in Scripture, and from those we can know absolutely that we should do those things. So, for example, we have 13 of our members in another country this evening, and they're doing missions, and we know that the Great Commission is repeated throughout the Gospels. We don't have to pray about whether or not we should do missions. We ought to do missions. It's just commanded. But I think sometimes people get so caught up in the things that aren't clearly explained in Scripture of what they're supposed to do that they can actually focus more on what is God's will for this situation than who God is, when in reality, that God wants to work through you his will. He wants to do things through you, and you're hesitating, and you're waiting, and in essence, you're not being a good steward of your time. That is, in most Christians' lives, God's will is something they seek, hopefully, when they're young, and it's broad and it's wide, but as God works in their life and reveals the giftings and abilities that they have and that God wants to use, that will should narrow and narrow and narrow down till they're finally doing the thing that God designed them to do. Because God designed something for each and every one of you in this room to be doing for him. And if we'll each do the thing that God designed us to do, then the church will function at its best. And will be the light and testimony that it ought to be. Now, I'm a list guy. I like the summer because the list gets shorter and I start knocking out the things that are on the list. The schedule's a little bit different. But I'm a list guy, and my favorite type of list, believe it or not, is a to-do list, as long as things are getting crossed off it. Because that's obvious that stuff's getting done. But in verses 3 through 12, God not only gives us a to-do list, but he also gives us a to-will list. There's things that God wants you to be willing to do. And while you're seeking God's will, it's the verses that come before 13 that make it very clear what his will is. Look at 13 again. For it is God, all things start with him, which worketh in you both to do these two things, to will and to do what? His good pleasure. So first of all, God's will is for his pleasure. We are here to serve him, to glorify him, and in glorifying Jesus, we will glorify the Father. We're not here to do our own thing. And there has to come a point in our life when we realize that, because we're not going to move and grow and be used of God if we're still caught up in, I'll do God's will if it pleases me. No, God's will is that thing that pleases him, and that's what we ought to pursue. So tonight I have for you a to-will list and a to-do list. Let's start with the to-will list. Go to verse 3. It says, let nothing be done through strife or vainglory, but in lowliness of mind let each esteem other better than themselves. So what ought we to will? We ought to be willing to function in lowliness of mind. What is lowliness of mind? Well, I can tell you what it's not. It's not strife. It's not strife. We're not to adopt the mindset of our culture that we're supposed to climb a ladder. That's not supposed to be occurring in the church. It's not a place of strife. There should be no ministries in the church that are in competition one with another. That's a worldly mindset. That's not a Christian mindset. So it's not a strife. It's not a vainglory. It's not something we do simply so that we can be seen. That's not lowliness of mind. It's not something that we do so that we can be recognized. Because in the Christian life, the recognition is supposed to be for the Father. Jesus himself said that we do good works that men might see them and glorify our Father, not us. So it's not strife, it's not vainglory. What is it? It's esteeming others better than yourself. So what does that mean? Well, it's not this false humility that some Christians put on and say that they're worthless and they're nothing. Because when you say you're worthless and nothing, then you're saying that your Creator didn't do a good job. But it is identifying things in other people's lives and promoting them because you see God's gifts working through them. It's becoming 100% committed to someone else's success. I was working with a former graduate the other week, and she was getting a little bit overwhelmed, and I had to tell her, you know, remember, I'm here to help you, and yes, you can give me work to do. And I had to remind her that I'm 100% committed to her success. This evening, while I preach here, I had such a strange experience yesterday. I went to the airport, but I wasn't the one leaving. And they were going to to a country that I would love to go to. But they were being led by someone that I taught. And I'm 100% committed to his success because he's ministering to my children even now. And by the way, he's the one I went with on the first missions trip I ever went there. That's how I got there. So it's finding giftings and abilities. They're going to visit an orphanage. And in that orphanage, those that play instruments will be able to minister in that orphanage better than I can ever minister when I go there. Because music moves the kids in that orphanage. It goes across language, and it does something for them that I cannot do. And so it's seeing those talents and abilities in others. Nathan played tonight. I can't do that. I on purpose picked instruments that did not involve my mouth because of the whole breathing issue. But do we find those things in other people? Do we esteem others better than ourselves? Do we see the ways that God has gifted them, and then do we put them in a position to succeed? So that's really what it is about, position, right? Because strife or vainglory is you seeking the position, but esteeming others better than themselves is putting people in position to use the gifts that God gave them, and that means you take the background. And that's okay. And that's okay. We had a great missions trip this last time, but for me, the best part of the missions trip is that I brought someone that I had discipled and they had moved into the position of a teacher. I used to go for missions, I'll be honest, because it's exciting. You're in a foreign country and you know that everything you're teaching them is going to be multiplied, and you have the opportunity at least there to affect an entire region of a country. But as I've done more and more missions trips, the bigger thing is to take people from this church and bring them there and see if they cannot do what I do, so that there are more people doing the work. And that is esteeming others better than yourself. So what is on God's to-will list to have lowliness of mind? How about verse 4? Look not every man on his own things, but every man also on the things of others. The second thing you ought to be willing to do is look out for others, not just yourself. Are we concerned about what's going on in the life of other people? Are we noticing when they're overwhelmed, and are we helping them? Now, if you were to just read the first part of the verse up to the comma, you would think that you never look on your own things. It says, look not every man on his own things. But in the after the comma, there's an also. So I've noticed this thing about helping others. You can't help others until you're on top of your stuff. So as Christians, we have a responsibility to be on top of our stuff, because that's when we can genuinely help someone. You know, when we see somebody having a problem, it's one thing to say, oh, well, I wish I really could help you, but I've got too much to do myself, and then walk away. You haven't been great encouragement to that person. It's another thing to conduct yourself in your life in such a way that you're on top of your stuff and you can come alongside and you can give the time that they need, because you've taken care of your own responsibilities. How are we living our lives as Christians? In the responsibilities that God has given us in whatever area or vocation He's placed us, are we doing it in a sense of good stewardship, so that when ministry opportunities come up, we're able to? I mean, have you ever been there? You saw how bad it was for somebody, so you stopped and helped them out, but the whole time you were helping them out, it was running in your mind that you've got all these other things that you need to do, and you couldn't be 100% present with them. Think about how busy Jesus was, but He was 100% present with everybody that He was with. So, are you willing to look out for others, not just yourself? How about verses 7 and 8? But made Himself of no reputation, and took upon Him the form of a servant, and was made in the likeness of men. And being found in fashion as a man, He humbled Himself and became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. You know, as a Christian, as a believer, you have control over your reputation. You have control over your testimony. Will you make your reputation that of a humble servant? Jesus is the King of glory. He left heaven's throne room, and He took up the position of a servant. There is no position higher in the kingdom of God than that of a servant, because that's the position Jesus came. But not only did He served humbly. He served humbly. The only reputation He desired to have was that of serving His Father. How about we as Christians? Is our reputation that of a humble servant? That's what I'm praying for the kids this week. The kids went to church this morning and they were warm. I've been in that church before and seen Tanya teaching lessons and looked out the back door while preaching or some lesson is going on and animals are going down the street. It's quite the experience to see that. There's no air conditioning in there. Until the McKinneys came, there weren't fans there. There's fans there when they went this last morning. And there's a guy there that preaches, and he's a pastor, and he's humble. When we went to visit him to see his church on the last trip, he was building furniture for his Sunday school in the main auditorium. He'd literally moved all the chairs out, and it became a place of construction while he made those tables for those people. And he humbly feeds kids 3 times a week because their parents are at work, and if he doesn't do it, they're not going to eat lunch. He served with a missionary, and that missionary had like a 5-acre piece of property. And sadly, the missionary lost his support. So he literally wrote the deed, well, he was willing to write the deed over to the pastor because he watched how much he had served. And the pastor said, well, if you give the property, I'd rather you give it to the church. And so now he farms that property so he can feed those kids three times a week. And because there isn't a grocery store close enough, so he can sell any of the excess pretty much at a loss so that the people in the village can eat better. That's humble service. Are we willing to make our reputation like that? You know, it's kind of rough when you go on a missions trip and the locals, they put you to shame by the way that they live. But it's instructive. It's instructive. Verse 11, the Bible says, and that every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. Could you do this? Could you make Jesus Lord in your life now rather than later? There'll come a point where there is no choice. I fear there's Christians that are living right now, and I wonder if they'll be comfortable when they walk into heaven, because heaven is completely about God, His Son, and the Holy Spirit. Do you know God's gracious and gives us a chance to make our life about those things now? So that when we walk into heaven, we'll be relieved. We'll be relieved that all the distractions are gone and that we're finally living the thing that we've been striving to do, because it's easy to do there. But one way or the other, there will come a point in your life where Jesus will be Lord. It just would be really great if we did it now. Some of you have been so kind, and you've given to the missions trips that I've participated in. And I always sign the missions correspondence this way: serving where sent. Are you willing to be sent? And when, wherever you're sent, are you willing to serve? Because if Jesus is Lord, that's really what we ought to do. It's just really what we ought to do. We ought to serve where sent. And then look at verse 12. Verse 12, a lot of people struggle over verse 12, so we're going to talk a little bit about it. Wherefore, my beloved, as ye have always obeyed, not as in my presence only, but now much more in my absence, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. So, are you willing to fear and tremble? God's given you a great opportunity to work out your salvation in your life. I didn't say a works salvation. I said, since you're saved, will you work it out in your life? Now, I don't know how much experience you have with lifting weights, but I went to school in Illinois. And Illinois has this crazy law that when you go to school, you have to have PE every day unless you are in a sport. And I know this will shock some of you, but I was never in a school sport. So I had to take PE every day. Well, when you're a PE teacher in Illinois and you have to have PE every day, you play sports 3 days a week, and then on the other 2 days, it's calisthenics and weightlifting. So hard to believe, but I had to weightlift quite a bit. Then I went to a college for ministry, and they said I had to take 2 PEs. So I took tennis, of course. Don't be ridiculous. But after that, I had to choose another. And so my roommate, he convinced me, because he liked to play basketball, oh, we should take weight training together. We'll do it the basketball way, not the football way. You won't get big. We'll just do the easy things, and, you know, you just, okay, whatever. But I have been there. I have been, trying to do the bench press, and to impress, I put too much on the bench press. There is a sense of fear and trembling in that workout, right? Because if your arms begin to tremble, you begin to fear if that's going to fall on your chest. And will you ever get up off the bench? But there's also a sense of trust. Because if you're lifting right, there's somebody behind you. Somebody who can put one hand between your two hands and help you finish and get off that bench. Or if it's really bad, put two hands on the outside of your two hands. And that's God. Because you don't grow unless you push up against this world. And you don't grow unless you face some resistance. But God's spotting you. And He'll put His hand in there. And He only needs one hand. He'll put His hand in there and lift that weight off you when it gets to be too much. We don't work for our salvation, but after we work, after we're saved, we ought to work. You know, in Greek, salvation is a point-in-time action with continuing results. I fear sometimes as Christians, we think that it's a point-in-time action with delayed results. that we get saved and the results are when we show up in heaven. But that's not the image in the Greek. In the Greek, it is a point in time action with continuing results. That is, people ought to be able to continually look at your life and see the results of salvation. And that only happens if you make effort in that direction, if you join effort with God and you work out your salvation. And that's immense as a theological idea. That's what ought to bring the fear and trembling, that you coordinate with God to become more like his son. So that's the to will list. Will you have lowliness of mind? Will you look out for others, not just yourself? Will you make your reputation that of a humble servant? Will you make Jesus Lord in your life now rather than later? And will you fear and tremble? But what about that to-do list? Well, we have to go back to verse 7. So while we're in the pursuit of God's will, which really ought to be a pursuit of God, there are some things that we can be doing. Look at verse 7. It says, but made himself of no reputation and took upon him the form of a servant and was made in the likeness of men. So what can we do while we're waiting for this will of God to be revealed to us? We can serve. But notice in the verse, it says that he took upon him the form of a servant. We really know that Jesus was a leader. So what if you get a chance to be a leader? Well, then if you lead, do it by serving. Because that's the example of the New Testament, servant leadership. It's a foreign concept in our culture. We kind of have an idea of you climb the ladder, you get to the top, and you get to rest. But that's never in the New Testament, so certainly wasn't a picture of Paul's life. So serve. And if you get to lead, do it by serving. About verse 8. And being found in fashion as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. So while you're waiting for God to reveal his will, don't just serve, but obey. So there's the declared will of God in the Word of God. So if you're seeking the permissive will of God in something not covered by the Scriptures, you can practice getting ready for when that's revealed to you by obeying what is already revealed. So we serve, we obey. Verse 10, that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow. You can do some bowing. Now, when I grew up, I grew up in a Lutheran church. And literally, during every service, there was times to bow. Because there was times to bow, they had this thing called a kneeler. We had, old school pews, and on the back and the bottom, there was a kneeler. And there was an amazing thing that happened in the service every time we kneeled. As soon as the kneeler started coming down, nobody talked. Did you know there's a time to stop talking to God? And there's a time to listen to what God wants to tell you? And it kind of falls out of fashion in our culture that we would actually bow. But bowing's it's a good idea. Because that's when you stop talking to God about all the things that you want to happen and you start listening for what needs to happen in your life. So you can serve, you can obey, you can bow. How about verse 11? And every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Then while you're waiting for that permissive will, you can confess. You can confess Christ. Because every time you confess Christ, you automatically bring glory to the Father. And you fulfill God's will for your life. Which is, if we're to become in the image and likeness of who Jesus is, then we ought glorify the Father. So you can confess Jesus Christ to others, because when you do so, you glorify the Father. And then we already saw it in verse 12. It says, wherefore, my beloved, as you have always obeyed, not as in my presence only, but now much more in my absence, work out your salvation, your own salvation, with fear and trembling. Well, that's repetition. So I had this roommate, his name was Luke, and he was a pretty important guy in my life. During college, he was a missionary kid from Argentina, and so he wanted to go do the basketball workout. So I have no clue, right? And so that's high reps. That's high reps. Less weight, high reps. And so if you're seeking God's will, you ought to high rep. You ought to serve, obey, bow, confess, serve, obey, bow, confess, serve, obey, bow, and confess till God reveals that thing to you. Are we willing to do that? Because if you do, then you'll be working with God in your salvation. People will see the results. Pastor asked me to share with you at the same time as preaching about the Dominican Republic. And so I'm going to try to illustrate some of the things that we talked about in the message on this last trip. So on this last trip, you know, you talk about working out your salvation with fear and trembling. It's been an honor to work with Eddie on the mission field, to kind of grow up with Eddie. When I first got there, Eddie was my translator. He was a young guy. It was significantly obvious that he was from a different generation than me. And he would translate for me, but he brings some energy that, you know, I didn't typically bring to the classroom. But over time, he's gone from the translator to the assistant to Gus to taking over Gus's position. And for a guy of his age, he has a ridiculous amount of responsibility, both financial and over people. And yet he does it with humility. One of the neatest things that happened on this trip is he admitted to me that he keeps inviting me and other people down who sadly don't show up very often. I want you to know, as a church, you're doing a great thing by sending us, because we're the most consistent ministry to minister to them. A lot of people say yes. Very few people actually show up. While I was there, he said, you know, I keep getting people to come teach because I don't have a degree. So I've decided I need to go get that degree. Now, if you would understand the immense amount of responsibility he has, the idea of trying to attempt a bachelor's degree, 120 credits, in the midst of what he's doing, but yet that's humility. That's humility. While we were there, Michael took us out to dinner with his wife. His wife is facing very serious surgery for her cancer. She has 2 young children. And yet I could sit there through translation, obviously, hear her give a testimony. But here's the thing, something that you don't need translation for: the countenance of her face, the dependence upon God's will in the midst of a cancer that very literally could take her life and leave her children motherless. She attended all of Karen's conferences and all those sessions, that she's still seeking after God in everything that's going on in her life. And to be honest with you, it's the healthiest I've ever seen her. But I don't think it's her health. I think it's just God coming right through her. That's humility. That's fear and trembling. One of the people on the missions trip right now that's in the Dominican Republic, you can pray for them. There was a serious situation between their family and my family in the school this year. You know, those things can get touchy. And they're here so often, you can't avoid them. So I wanted to be careful and make sure that I greeted them. And the love and peace and humility that came out of that person, when I know what someone else in my family put in their life, that's God. That's God. Do we have that kind of testimony? Some new things that we got to do. We got to go to a church in Coletta that has a clinic. And I don't know if you realize this, but Coffee, there's another guy, right? Coffee, he's going through all this stuff. Coffee got a pallet of medical supplies. And I don't know if you understand how important. Imagine going to Walmart and just going to the pharmacy section and just looking at the over-the-counter of the stuff. They don't have that. They don't have any of that. And so one time we got a shipment from Coffee, and we hadn't had a shipment in a long time, and it got to the point where Maciel was like, do you think you could get us any more of that kind of stuff? Now, they run a mobile medical clinic on campus. They have a clinic on their campus, and now they're working with Coletta, which I love the churches in the Dominican. They're not content to be open Sunday and Wednesday. They have to be doing something every day. Every day they have to be ministering. So this place has a clinic, and we got to go visit that clinic in Coletta. And Coffee, he gave, again, like a pallet of resources from Walmart, and we keep shipping them box by box by box. And yet, to see all those things go out and minister to people's needs. We got to go to a different Christian school. The McKinneys have gone on a past trip, and we pretty much maxed out what we could do with the preschool and elementary that we had been ministering to. But Eddie has been put on the board of another Christian school, and we went there, and it's amazing. I mean amazing. They started off with 49 students. They're at 490. They've grown 10% every single year for 10 years. And while we were there, they were in the midst of a building project, and they needed more money in order to build. And then their school is in San Pedro, and they teach half the day English and half the day Spanish. Once you're past fourth grade, you have to take classes in both. And it's American English, because they want them to sound like Americans. I found that pretty ironic, that when I was there in the Dominican, they wanted Dominicans to sound like Americans. I already told you about Brother Joel and all the things. Please pray for our kids. They're going to be in the sugarcane village there of Olivares for 5 days. They went today and they had church, and they're beginning to get contacts for their VBS. And tomorrow they're going to go and they're going to paint widows' houses, and they're going to play with kids, and they're going to take turns doing that. And then starting the next day, they're going to have 3 days of VBS. And normally, Joel has about 35 kids in his church, and he'd like it to be 70, and he'd like the opportunity to reach to those parents. And our group has a chance to help him grow his church. Will you pray that they're able to do that? Now, they're going to get to do something that I have not got to do. There's going to be two camps that are going to run in the week that they're down there. They're going to have a camp of 300, and they're going to have a camp of 400. One of those camps is overnight. So you can pray for them. They're going to be setting up all the games, and they're going to be reffing the games. How they do that in another language, I don't know. And they're going to be involved in a lot of drama, the good kind. They do dramas there. And so they're going to have an opportunity. Think about this. They're going to have an opportunity to minister to an estimated 770 people while they're there. I cannot tell you unless you go what it is like, how much you can get done in 1 week there. So will you pray for them? We left them so many supplies, and if any of the boxes got there before they did, they have more supplies than they probably know what to do with. But can I thank you for those things too? You know, the things that we're done with, they're treasures to them. Recently, I loaded a bunch of stuffed animals into a box that will be shipped. And to you and I, those are stuffed animals. They're just simply toys, things people don't need. Do you know to a Dominican child, that's their pillow? Because they don't have pillows. We talked earlier this morning about shoes. I think it was in Sunday school. Jacob was teaching, and he was talking about the servant. One of the ideas you could know a servant is because they don't have shoes. I remember the first time I took my kids. I've taken each of my kids one trip at a time, and the bunch of kids out playing soccer, and James asked me, "Dad, why are they playing soccer without their shoes? Well, they don't have shoes." So we pray for our kids. One of the best things that could happen on this missions trip is they come back with a mission. They realize that God can use them, that at their age, that they don't have to wait to start working out their salvation, but that they have gifts and talents, abilities that God can use now, that they could be serious about the things of God at their age. Would you pray for them? Would you pray for Jennifer? She's a nurse. I'm glad she's going. There's a clinic in Coletta. There's a mobile medical clinic. There's the clinic on campus. Would you pray for Jennifer while she's there? There's a lot of things going on in the Dominican Republic. My wife's class got so big that they took all the tables between them and the cafeteria. So it's good to have growing problems. In our logistics meeting, we said we had to buy more tables because her class is rapidly approaching the size of the men's conference, which is great because if you walk into a Dominican church, it's mostly ladies. Actually, to be honest, it's mostly kids and then ladies. Can you pray that guys in the Dominican would begin to step up? I got to preach in a church, Pastor Rudy's church. We asked him about the number of deacons, and he said, "Well, just to be honest with you, I don't have guys that are qualified." Could you pray for that? That would change? When we talked to him at the end, could you pray for wisdom and discernment about opportunities? He wants to have a conference in his church. We met a new translator. He came and he did song leading. He and his wife translated for Karen, and he translated for me, and he was so excited that Ray brought the exchange material that he's going to do it immediately. It'll be done by the time we get back. And he's asked us to go visit his church and preach there in San Cristobal. And then there's another church, Pastor Ramon, who wants me to preach in his church in San Pedro. Property there is a big deal. Like, to find property that has a title that is clear is nearly impossible. So they have a very small piece of land. So what they did is decide to build their church three stories high. And he'd like us to come and preach in his church. There's just so much there. There's people in need. Any one of you that walked into that country would be rich. Will we continue to minister there? Will you pray for wisdom and discernment? At this point, pastors approved for me to go to three different trips next summer, in the summer of 2020, and to begin replicating the ministry that's in the Dominican, in the country of Nicaragua, and in Mexico. I don't know if you realize the impact that this church, this local body, can have. But it's going to take a lot for that to happen. It really is. So would you pray? But more so, would you pray about you yourself? You know, I'm an ordinary guy, and I don't speak Spanish. But God lets me go. What about you? Will you pray? Will you give? Preacher taught me to pray and to give and to do it faithfully. Did you know that if you pray and you give faithfully, you'll end up going? You'll end up going. Now, again, I went to the airport and I wasn't the one leaving. So it was really strange. So I'm here and they're there. You know, if I was there, I'd want my church praying for me.